Friends, I welcome you here tonight for a very somber occasion, but also for a celebration of a life that has been so well lived. We give thanks for Betty Wildman. And tonight, we celebrate her life while we also worship God, because we remember that in living, Christ showed us a way, that in dying, Christ destroyed death. And in rising, he shows us that what we think the end is yet another beginning. So we gather on this night, remembering, celebrating, and knowing that we are not alone. God walks with us in our grief and walks before us in our hope. So I invite you to join with me in an attitude of prayer. God, you have arms that can hold us when we feel unsteady, that can strengthen us when we feel weak, and arms that can comfort us when we weep. And on this night, we just ask that your arms would wrap around us in mercy and in grace. As we tremble now, standing on this side of the mystery of death, we ask that you would calm us and help us, that you would remind us yet again of your story of resurrection, of hope. And as we find comfort in that, help us also see beyond just this night, but also into the future, where there is never anything that can separate us from your love. So God, we thank you for how you comfort us now and you guide us. You even give us words to pray when words escape us. So now, Lord, help us to be one voice, praying the prayer that you taught so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Invite Rachel to come forward to share.
I found myself having a hard time writing this because 96 years is a lot of life, and it was difficult to capture that in so many words. But I can hear my grandmother saying that just to tell them everybody about her stories and the things that she enjoyed, so that's what I'm going to do. Meemaw, as her grandchildren called her, lived an extraordinary life that many of us wish to live. She was a clean freak sister who would chase after her siblings if they made any kind of mess. She loved learning and educating herself as much as possible. She was the first woman in her family to graduate from college and had high expectations for her own children and grandchildren. Whenever my mom would threaten to show Meemaw my grades, I knew it was time to get serious. She loved the Lord so well. She bought me my first Bible. She prayed over every meal we ate together and could quote scripture. She loved movement and exercise. Meemaw would walk to pick me and my sisters up from elementary school, and we would have to jog to try to keep up with her. She loved to make clothes, and we would often find her at her sewing machine repairing and creating an outfit. She loved baking, and some of her staples in our family were her homemade bread, strawberry jam, apple cake, party pizzas, 7-layer cookies, and the list just goes on. She would always be the last person to join the table as she wanted to make sure everyone had what they needed first. She wrote thank you cards to everyone, and I mean everyone. She wanted to make sure that everyone knew how valued they were. And if you wrote her a thank you card, she made it her purpose to keep the card. And I know this to be true because I found all of them this week, and I've never seen so many cards in my life. She loved the Tennessee Vols. You would never not find her wearing her orange on game day. She loved going to the Lady Vols basketball game with her best friend, Betty Adams. She loved taking pictures, especially of her babies, as she called us. Meemaw had a particular way of taking photographs. She would get in a squat position, even though she didn't need to, and take the photograph. In my family, we refer to this as the Meemaw squad. She loved photographs and taking pictures, and she made the best scrapbooks and loved sharing them with people. She loved traveling to new places. She would tell me and my sisters to go and see as much of this world as possible. Great memories you'll never forget, she said. She loved Christmas. Every year for Christmas, me and Meemaw would decorate her whole house. She would put on her favorite Bing Crosby record, and we would get to decorating. She told me where she got all of her decorations from, but the one that she was the most proud of didn't come from a store, but was an angel made out of a magazine that my Uncle Fred made her when he was 6 years old. She kept it all of those years. Meemaw took great pride in her house and everything her and my grandfather had built. I would stay with her sometimes on Friday nights. At night, she would cover me with a hand crocheted blanket that she made. And on Saturday mornings, I would wake up to the smell of pancakes. She always made pancakes on Saturdays. We would eat breakfast and then get to cleaning. She also always cleaned on Saturdays. We would scrub, dust, and wipe everything in the house. And I know to many this doesn't sound like fun, but I loved it. It made me feel a sense of control, but it also got Meemaw to tell me all the stories about all her knickknacks, photographs, and memories she had in the house. She shared so much with me. She always told me that I kept things the tidiest, but I had the best teacher when it came to cleaning and organization. She could grow the most beautiful flowers, and the one that she particularly loved was her Mr. Lincoln flower that smelled the sweetest. She saved every bag, tissue paper, and wrapping paper she ever received and would make you do the same. Meemaw loved many things, but she loved her family, especially her family. I could sit for hours and listen to her tell me stories about the time that she would grow up on a farm, or the time that she told off one of my mother's school teachers for being unkind to her, or the time that she apparently locked her keys and myself in the car when I was an infant and hysterically tried to get me out. She was funny, firm, thoughtful, selfless, and loving. Her love is the love that is described in 1 Corinthians 13. I wanted to end on this story. One summer, me and my sister Molly spent a week at Meemaw's house. My parents and my other sister Sarah went on a mission trip, so we stayed with her. Meemaw was a firm believer that kids should spend most of their days outside, so around 11 o'clock, she would kick us out of her house to go be a kid. As a kid, I loved basketball, but I never had a basketball goal, so I figured that throwing a basketball into a trash can was the closest thing I would get. Meemaw came outside to check on me and found me shooting my basketball into the trash can. She gave me a strange look and asked if I needed anything, and then went back into the house. 3 weeks later, I went back over to her house to visit, pulled in, and saw a basketball goal sitting in the driveway. She came out and said, "At my house, you shoot your basketball into a net." She supported me in all my hobbies, even the dumb ones, and would join me on occasion because her love for me was endless. Her love for all of her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren was endless. She loved her family, friends, and her community. Meemaw just loved people. All her life, she loved people. She was a God-fearing, strong, loving, resilient woman who never stopped thinking about other people. Whether you called her Betty, Miss Wildman, Mom, or Meemaw, there's one thing you knew for sure, that she was a special lady with a special heart that loved people deeply. Meemaw, we love you a bushel and a peck and a hug around the neck.
Standing, and I want to turn, or it's actually in your hymnal or on page 881, the affirmation of faith. This is our new, these are new words to you. These are words that we often share in worship to remind us of the basics of what we believe, and these are words that Betty felt strongly about. So I invite you to join with me in these words as they're printed in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you'll remain standing for the reading of Scripture.
Friends, hear these words from the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. May peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the word of our Lord Jesus Christ for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. When I spoke with Doug and Susan, I asked them the question, what about your mother and mother-in-law do you think we should lift up above all else? What part of her life truly captured who she was? And without hesitating, Both of them said almost in unison that it was her time as a grandmother, and Rachel's eulogy was a tremendous image of that love for us here. The passions of her words and the emotions we could all feel remind us of that love Betty poured into so many, especially her grandchildren. While Don and I were meeting to organize and plan this funeral service, he described Betty as the archetype of a Meemaw, as her grandkids lovingly called her. And here's the thing, she was a grandmother not only to her own grandchildren, but to so many in this community. As a member of Fountain City United Methodist Church, it was her ministry to go from hospital to hospital, visiting all the newborns, bringing the families roses and a loaf of her fresh-baked bread or the green beans she had canned from her garden the summer before. Doug and Susan shared with me that one of those babies that she went to visit and just happened to get a picture with was a newborn Carlton Searcy, who of course grew up to become one of her grandchildren by marriage when he married Molly, and she loved him just like one of her own. In fact, when Betty's health began to decline, and I let Doug know that I was going to go see her at Holston Rehab, Doug jokingly told me to let her know that I'm friends with Carlton because he was probably her favorite grandchild. Of course, he was joking, just in case anyone needs that affirmation. The passages I read from John 14 today, which come from our United Methodist Book of Worship, really made me think about all the stories that Susan shared with me about Betty just after her passing. Susan talked lovingly and fondly of her childhood and those childhood friends, Craig Holtzclaw and David Hughes, are people who are active members of this church. Craig is up in the sound booth helping us with technology right now, and all the other kids from the Sportsman Club that she grew up with, and how all the moms in that community, including her own, were like second parents to all her close friends. Betty really did go before everyone she loved in her life, not just in her death, to make a place for them in God's kingdom. She made sure that from the moment children were born in this community, they were welcomed into this church family with all the love and care that they would need to thrive in Christ Jesus. As a mother, she made sure to instill the values of hard work and, above all else, Christian service into her children, leading by example as a nurse. As a grandmother, she raised up 6 granddaughters and 3 grandsons with a love that can only be shown by a grandmother who takes her faith and the faith of her family seriously. As Betty departs this world, I know, having listened to all these stories of her love and her witness, not only from her family, but also from her beloved friends and family here at this church, that she goes on in the love, peace, and grace of the Holy Spirit to once again do what she's always done in life and to prepare a place for her family to follow her into God's kingdom. While it's okay to cry and it's okay to mourn, and those are good and healthy and holy things to do when we lose those we love, do not forget that she lives now in eternal peace with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that there will never be a final goodbye because of the love she poured into all of you and the example she made for her family and her friends. Because of that love, you all will be reunited with her again. And in the words of that old hymn, it will be soon and very soon. Thanks be to God for Betty Wildman and this family she's lifted up and to this community she's brought together. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. I think this church is a church home for me. I've been able to serve it twice now. I came as an associate pastor in 2002, and the reason I tell you that, because I've served for a year, for 8 years, and I've come back now as a pastor again. But what I remember distinctly was on that first Sunday, being a young pastor right out of seminary, trying to project an image of confidence, but yet struggling with my own insecurities in front of so many people. And then standing in the back, greeting people as folks left, and Betty coming to me and looking at me. Before I could say anything else, she had wrapped me up in a big hug. And I didn't know how much I needed a grandma hug in that moment. And that's the way it worked. From there on out, every Sunday, we always gave each other a hug. Her hugs were golden, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. Such a sweet, sweet lady. And I also can remember how Miss Huser and Miss Adams and Betty, they would, like teenage schoolgirls, they would gather up in the narthex, and they would giggle and lean in with each other and laugh, and it was just, it delighted me to see how much love they had for each other, but also how much they loved the church. Betty came out of the Christian fellowship class, and that was, and is still is, an amazing class of people in our church, many whom grew up during the Great Depression or on the tail end of the Great Depression and knew what it was like to suffer through a world war. And that class really set a tone for the DNA of who we are as a church and how you have to figure out a way that you may have a disagreement with somebody about whatever it may be, but you can figure out a way to move forward in peace and in hope and in deep friendship still. And I can't help but think of how that probably also was something she learned as a kid, how to make compromises and how to work things out, because you all know that she is a clean freak, and her older sister she had to share a room with, we'll just say wasn't. But they shared a dresser, so Betty would clean off her half of the dresser, and it was spotless. The other half was just what you would expect it to be. So you know, she figured out how to share things, even if you didn't have the same understanding of how they worked. And that is just a gift in a certain generation of people that I pray carries forward in us. But honestly, I find it hard to think about Betty without thinking about her husband, Charlie. I never met him, but I'm not sure there was many times she would talk and didn't bring up Charlie in some form or fashion. Some of you know that he played football at UT. He played with Vernon Huser. And I remember those two guys and others who would gather together in the narthex, and they would talk about plays and games. And it was so fun to hear them talk and then understand Charlie, whom I've never met, was part of that. And there was stories that would include him as well. But he graduated from UT, and she had graduated from Memphis and with a nursing degree. And some of you may know, she wasn't a veteran, but she went to become a nurse as the war was coming to an end because she wanted to serve her country. And she ended up going to school on Uncle Sam's dime. So from then on out, I mean, you could have asked her 10 months ago, and if you said, Betty, the country needs you, she would have said, I am there. I mean, she just felt, just she wanted to serve her community, and what better way to do that than as a nurse? But anyways, she was working at Fort Sanders. He had graduated working at a high school here in town as a coach and a teacher, and then a mutual friend introduced them on a blind date. And I just thought that would have been hilarious to watch from a distance, as they would have met this northerner from Connecticut. And they met and apparently hit it off. And by that fall, she took the step of introducing him to her dad. Now, for those who are familiar with Tennessee in the fall, you think of football. But back then, fall is hog killing time, okay? So they had hogs. So she brings this Connecticut boy to the house on a day they're killing hogs. So he shows up, and Daddy is there with all of what you would have on you if you've been killing hogs. And he's holding a machete. They walk up, and Betty's like, "I want you to meet somebody, Dad." The words out of his mouth were, the edited version, "You're not one of those darn Yankees, are you?" Can you imagine Charlie when he's kind of like, "Yes, sir, I am." But that didn't scare him off because he knew the gift he had in Betty. And they had many, many years together as an amazing couple, an inspiration to you, to me. The legacy of that kind of marriage of love lives on in this family, and I give God thanks for that. Betty loved Jesus, loved her family, and loved her church. And she was one of those folks, as a pastor, you open up the doors, and she's one of the first folks to roll in. And she was a behind-the-scenes person who loved us. She was a worker bee. She would never have called herself a leader, but she led by example that inspired others. We have a, back in the day, we had a thing called backyard missions, basically meaning we need to be involved in the community right here. And part of that was kind of a benevolence response with food scarcity issues and otherwise. And she loved to serve in that. We also continue to have a meal on Wednesday nights, but this was back in the day when Marvin Holtzclaw was our cook as opposed to Doug. And she was back there with the other ladies, and I think they were called the salad girls. And then they would have to chop up all the salad, no pre-bagged stuff. You had to chop it up. And they loved that. United Methodist women there, there was a small cadre of them. They called them the Golden Girls, and they worked in the kitchen. I don't know how many different clubs of girls she was a part of, but she just knew how to gather people around her, and they'd work and work hard. She also, as you know, was part of the choir. And she was very good at recruiting people. I think, if I understand correctly, she recruited Fran and Keith, and then recruited Sarah Galloway and even Doug. Imagine that. So, but she always wanted to share what was happening in her church because she loved her church and she knew the impact of this church on people's lives and how transformative that could be. So she would invite people with green beans, as they were said, or homemade bread, or whatever it was. She loved her church. And she was so amazingly resilient, though, even when things were hard in her life. When I visited her just a few weeks ago, and you walk into a room, and she was asleep. And you could tell she was in pain even though she was in sleep. And her angel, Susan, was there taking care of her. Because that's what she called her, rightfully so. But when your eyes would open and she would talk with you, there was a graciousness and a joy that was you could not mistake that would kind of erupt out of that bed. And she wanted to know how you were doing. And you were there to visit her. She was just such a loving, amazing lady. These last few weeks have been hard for her, yet she remained steadfast. And as I understand it, I mean, many of you know this already, that she really loved chocolate Frosties from Wendy's, right? And if you brought her one, she would say, "Bless your heart. Bless your heart." That was a way for her to say thank you. And you've heard her say, if you've ever given her anything, I'm guessing she said, "Bless your heart." Hold both of your hands together when she said it. Bless your heart. Her heart was in a good place. And it reminds me of a passage in Romans about a heart that's in a good place, even though things around them may not be easy. Some of you know the book of Romans was written in a time when many who are followers of Jesus were suffering terribly. Paul, a writer of significant parts of our New Testament, wrote this letter to encourage. I'm going to read from Romans 8, verses 31 and following. Paul, speaking about the suffering they were enduring, he says, "What then shall we say in response to these things, these sufferings? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Jesus Christ, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, nor the present nor the future, nor any powers, no height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Nothing can separate you from that love. Betty loved so well because she trusted in that kind of love that was real in her, and she couldn't help but spill it out all over you if you were around her. Her heart was in a good place. And I recognize that some of us, we love Betty, but we may not have much of a relationship with the church anymore. And I can understand that, because there's probably been people dressed like me, looks like me, stands in front of a group like you, who have said very hurtful, judgmental, or mean-spirited things. And you've said, you know what? I am done with church. I can understand that. But if you're done with church, I ask you not to give up on Jesus, because Jesus has not given up on you. Betty would never give up on you. And she wouldn't give up on you because she knows that there's a Jesus who wants to pursue you in love and help you find your way back home. So I don't know what your journey is, but I know our journey tonight is here because we love the lady who loved us. And that love came from a very good place. And it came because she was following a man who absolutely changed the world and can change your world too. I invite you to pray with me. God, we thank you for how when we face death, we can be reminded that we're going to be okay. Because your son has showed us a way, even when things were hard, has shown us a way, even through death, that a resurrection is possible. So Lord, help us carry on. Help us stay close to each other and stay close to you. Help us not wander ourselves too far away from what it means to be family or to understand the power of your love. God, I know how you must have been so pleased with Betty and her love. And I pray that as grandchildren, as her children, as they have opportunities in their life to express love, they would see that just as a continuation of your love that you put in her heart. Thank you, God, for how you are with us on this night. Again, Lord, we appeal to you and we ask that your grace would deal tenderly with our hearts so that we would have a peace that surpasses understanding. Thank you, Lord. For your love is sufficient for all, because there is nothing that can separate us from that love. We offer this prayer to you as we celebrate her life and celebrate what it means to have you in our life as well. And all God's people said, amen. I invite you to stand as you're able to sing our closing hymn, number 378, Amazing Grace.
remain with you always. Because now, Betty has gone before you, all of you, to make a place, just as she did in life. Now so she does too in her passing. Go now in the peace of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.